two.
I have a material witness on an aggravated battery with a handgun and
Greetings, world. We are anonymous. Most of the world, the political left in particular, was blindsided by the results of the 2016 election. To say that some are having a hard time coming to terms with the words President Trump, and what the next 4 to 8 years will bring, would be an understatement. Those who told you that a Trump presidency was impossible were quick to remix their pre-election narratives, framing the Donald as something of a Hitler 2.0 and attempting to position themselves as leaders of a new resistance. Self-reflection is still off the table. On the other end of the spectrum, you have those who took Trump's promises at face value, and who actually believe he will make America great again, proclaiming the dawn of a new age of conservatism, as the stock market rose to record highs, before he actually took office. Both sides are utterly unprepared for what's coming. Let's just cut to the chase. Is Trump going to usher in a new era of prosperity and innovation, or is he going to be the one standing in the center ring when the circus tent comes down? Remember, some voted for Trump as a political Molotov cocktail. Trump is a businessman. You say, he's going to make things happen. Cut taxes. Cut regulation. Invest $1 trillion in infrastructure, including a ginormous wall. Punish companies that move factories overseas. Rebuild the military, restore relations with Russia, start a trade war with China, and you know a new arms race would create jobs. There's a lot to unpack there, and those are debates worth having. However, much of this hinges on a variable that Trump doesn't control, the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve has held interest rates near zero for close to a decade. They also engaged in quantitative easing from 2009 to 2014, accumulating $4.5 trillion worth of mortgage-backed securities and treasury notes. They are still holding those assets, by the way. This inflated stock and bond market bubbles of historic proportions. When a friendly face is in the White House, crashes are typically attributed to a war, a terrorist attack, or some other external variable, for example 9/11. Which masked the unraveling of the tech bubble in 2001. The Trump administration, however, is an excuse in and of itself. Word is the Fed is leaning towards increasing interest rates aggressively in 2017, and may engage in any inflationary measures to offset Trump's infrastructure stimulus plans. That means that the flow of money and credit is about to be tightened. It also means the Fed is setting itself up for a showdown. If Trump plays by the rules, he will have to wait until 2018 to replace Janet Yellen. A lot can happen within that time frame. Trump's personality is a wild card. He's impulsive. He fights dirty. And he fights to win. He also happens to have a history with organized crime. If Trump goes to war with the Federal Reserve, this could get out of hand in ways that most can't even imagine, especially when geopolitics are factored in. As a result, the US dollar's position as the world reserve currency is going to be in play. Add to that a little social unrest on the domestic front. If recent history serves as any indicator, we can count on seeing some kind of racially charged flashpoint involving the police during the Trump administration, probably before 2017 is over. It's also fairly safe to say, given recent history, that some of these protests will turn violent and destructive. The trend has been towards escalation. Having Trump in charge will take this to a new level. Trump ran on a platform of law and order, and support for the police, which piggybacked on the perception that Obama was undermining law enforcement during his term, in spite of the fact that Obama greatly accelerated the militarization of the police. Just the belief that Trump has their back is going to influence the police response. They're going to be more confident, aggressive, and if Trump offers even so much as a word of encouragement, they will go into full crackdown mode, which would of course throw gasoline on a fire. These tensions, indefinitely. To top it off, Trump is filling his administration with former generals. Lee without Trump, however, will be in government. This provides a glimpse of the years to come. Israel's strategy is simple. Provoke Syria and or Iran until one of them retaliates. Which would of course provide cover to take territory. Turkey is likely to make another move and Iraq and or Syria as well. Turkey has ambitions to expand its borders as well. While the Saudis continue bombing Yemen to rubble, with US government support, Israel feels confident that Trump will defend them at all costs. Indeed, he has given this impression, but will he take the bait? Here Russia is a wild card. What happens if Russia moves quickly to provide Syria and Iran with the means of defending themselves? What happens when Putin and Netanyahu are competing for Trump's ear? With all the other variables in play, will Trump even have the means to influence the outcome in this region? Expect alliances in the Middle East to shift rapidly during the Trump years, with unexpected consequences. In particular, watch for a play on oil that undermines the petrodollar. Making America great again was never on the menu. Trump wasn't supposed to win. He was supposed to be the decoy. This was reality television does politics. Literally. The Democrats thought he was so bad that he would take attention off of Hillary's baggage. So the Clinton campaign pulled strings with their friends in the media to help him in the primaries. We know this thanks to the John POTUS email leaks. We need to be elevating the Pied Piper candidates Trump, Cruz, Carson, so that they are leaders of the pack and tell the press to take them seriously, the DNC, and their corporate media lackeys, then work to marginalize the Bernie Sanders campaign, and use a secret agreement backed by leverage to prevent him from attacking Clinton. This was confirmed by the DNC email leaks. Oops. You can't unthrow a Molotov cocktail. So get your popcorn, and buckle up. The show is about to begin.
I will build the wall and Mexico is going to pay for it and they'll be happy to pay for it.
I want to build a safe zone someplace in Syria. We have to get the Gulf states. They have nothing but money.
Don't trust them.
We got to get them to fund it. We got to get them to put up the money.
I will take care of women. I promise I will never be in a bicycle race.
If I'm president, you're going to see Merry Christmas in department stores. Believe me.
I would knock the hell out of the oil areas.
Would I approve waterboarding? You bet.
A whole bunch of empty promises.
I will find the General Patton, or I will find General MacArthur. I will find the right guy.
My generals, by the way, they're not going on television, okay?
Renegotiate our foreign trade deals. I want surveillance of certain mosques, okay? I will absolutely take database on the people coming in from Syria. And if I win, I've made it known, if I win, they're going back. We have to rebuild our infrastructure, our bridges, our roadways, our airports. Reduce our $18 trillion in debt. We are going to save Social Security, repeal Obamacare, and replace it with something really, really great that works. End Common Core.
I will take jobs back from China. I'll take jobs back from Japan. I'll take jobs back from Mexico.
Sadly, the American dream is dead.
I know, I was shocked when I heard that for the first time.
But if I get elected president, I will bring it back bigger and better and stronger than ever before. And we will make America great again.
Father, please walk with us through the bad times as well as the good. May we be heard and understood from the suburbs to the hood.
Gotta pray for him.
May you judge us by our hearts and not by our mistakes. And see that we get a breakthrough, however long that it takes. May you fill that void in our souls that will lay our fears to rest. Because there's no way we can live for Jesus when we're living in the flesh. So I pray that you allow our spirits to be born, grow strong, move on, know right from wrong. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or anything in the world. And we know what that means. But listen, we know the distance we need to be away from fire to keep it missing. That doesn't mean we'll listen. Lord, you take care of fools and babies. You teach women to honor their men and men respect their ladies. But lately, so many of us have gone astray, doing wrong for so long that we've forgotten the way. Please bring us back home, instill in us the word which is our backbone, which is children that act grown. There was so much that we were entitled to, yet we received so little. Because in this time of spiritual warfare, we're comfortable in the middle. So I pray that you open our eyes, give us the anointing to recognize the devil and his lies. If we keep our actions wise and our prayers sincere, our heads to the sky, you will diminish our fears. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen and amen.
3, 2, 1.
I have a material witness
on an aggravated battery with a handgun, and they believe might be a
CWA. Well, I'm not a crook.
To a testimony.